Good morning to you that are watching by live streaming. And just as a reminder, and the reason we do the countdown is this. Once we go live, these microphones pick up what you say, and so they may be live streaming some private conversation. So just be aware of it. That's sort of one of the reasons we do that. And we appreciate you being here at the very first day of 2023. Doesn't seem possible that another year's gone, but it has. And I see several places we're missing normal people that are normally here. It must have been a late night ringing in the new year. But we are glad that you are here, and I want to welcome you. We have those that are here for the very first time, and so we want you to make them feel welcome. One of the things I did at the men's breakfast this morning was I asked, just as a game, how many people that didn't come in 2021 started coming to Abundant Life in 2022, and we named off several couples and individuals that started coming, and so we want to continue to be a place where people can come and visit. Whether they stay or not is between them and God, but we want to make sure they feel loved and welcomed, and that this is a place that lifts up Jesus Christ. So we're glad that you're here if you've come today, and we will consider you as a part of us until you tell us you're not. So we're glad that you are here. In the bulletin, now what I do in my bulletin? Oh, ha-ha, there it is. You'll get, it's up here. You've got the different prayer requests that we have there. Hilton Harold, which is Chris Fortune's son-in-law that had a heart attack last Saturday, a week ago Saturday. So be in prayer for him. And you can see some of the others there that we had. And as we said, pray for individuals who have had loved ones pass away recently. Do that. We always have those that are dealing with some type of chronic illness or something. I won't tell you who, but they are in here, and they're in the back row on my left side, the very last seat. Now, I'm not telling you who, but they had a report that they had a cancer, and when they were going to have the scan, the CT scan to find it and everything, the individual said, and you can hear it from their own mouth if you think I'm making it up, it's not going to be there because I've asked God to take care of it and heal it because God's going to give me a wonderful Christmas and New Year. And the lady just chuckled and worked hard to find it, and it's not there. And so we've already had God doing miracles, and we thank God for it. And so you never can tell what God's up to. And so continue to pray for one another and the different needs that we have. Always pray for our country. Pray for the beginning of the new year. I've asked God to make us more fruitful in helping people know Him as Savior and grow in their faith than ever has been in the existence of this church. And so if you would, join me in prayer with that. Any other prayer requests that you want to give before we go to the Lord in prayer? Yes, Virginia?
I do. Well, the praise is thank you. My sister Dee Dee spent 33 days in the hospital, and she came home on Christmas Eve. And then, so she's getting better. And then my sister Lori, the one that helps with the Valentine banquet, I know a lot of you know her, she has hurt her shoulder really, really bad. Mm. And her surgery is this week on the 5th.
Okay.
So please pray for the doctors that God would guide their hands and for healing, fast healing. She's been in a lot of pain and not been able to use her arm very much. So. Okay.
Others? Oh. Yes.
Believe it or not, it is election season again.
Yes.
And there are those that are in our church group that are going to be running for local offices, and we really need to keep them in prayer because we need godly people to be in these offices.
And I know Steve's one of them. Have you officially said you would? Darlene is going to run in one of the districts. Three? Two. Two's our district. You're in three. So be in prayer for these people because this is not a political calling. It shouldn't be. This is a spiritual calling, standing for that which is right and that which will bless people's lives and homes and families and young people and educate them and not brainwash them. And so, be in prayer for these individuals that are trying to answer God's call. Any other prayer requests? Yes.
My son-in-law is having his surgery this week on Wednesday.
Okay.
On the tumor.
All right.
And just keep him in prayer because it's going to be a very tricky surgery.
Okay. Remember him in prayer. Rosemary?
I've got a couple. One, please keep my mom and dad still in prayer. My mom wound up in the hospital. Tim and I had COVID, so I couldn't go up. And Sister Connie's still very sick, never tested, but we believe it's COVID. So nobody could go with my mom. My dad escaped the facility and walked 3 miles to the hospital. And the facility didn't even know he was missing till 7:30, 8 o'clock that night. So never got his meds. They never knew he was missing. It's just been one nightmare after another with them. I just paid to have the phone repaired, and it's not working again. I don't know what they're doing to the... We wound up with a landline because the cell phone they never charged. They'd lose it. Anyway. So just be in prayer about that whole situation. It seems like one struggle after another. The other very strong prayer request, the family that you all met at Christmas, mm-hmm. that we helped, Jen is going Wednesday, has found another lump. She's had several in the past. This one has been rapidly growing. Mm-hmm. They're very concerned. So please be in prayer for her on Wednesday for her appointment. The last thing that family needs is another hardship to bear. So strongly, strongly keep them lifted in prayer, please.
All right. Anything else before we pray? Got plenty to pray about. So you talk to the Lord, so I talk to him out loud. Let's pray. Father, just because it's a new year doesn't mean that this world is not still sin-cursed. And it means that people aren't what they should be. It means that wars and evil will continue to be around. Sickness will continue to try to grip people's lives and rob them. Lord, I want to thank you that we can come to you with our needs. And you're a loving Heavenly Father. If you had not died on the cross, that might be a little harder to believe. But as you said in your word, if you were willing to take our eternal punishment on the cross, what good thing would you withhold if we're blessable? So in all these situations, Lord, we ask that we come in line with your word, that we discern what you're doing in these situations. Thank you for the one who discerned in this situation that Satan was trying to get them to receive something in their body that wasn't your will, and you took it away. And Lord, that doesn't mean, as we talked, that sometimes you ask us to walk with you through a valley and you just don't pluck us out of it. But either way, you have good for us. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, was what the psalmist David said. Lord, we pray for these people to turn their problems and their difficulties and their challenges unto you. We commit our leaders unto you. Those that are godly and those that are ungodly. Nobody could be in authority without your allowance, and we are commanded to pray that all hear your voice and govern according to the laws that are the laws of the kingdom of God. And so, Lord, we pray for that. We pray for revival among your people and for every church that preaches the truth. Pray for families that struggle and division in homes. And Lord, we pray for those that are aging and maybe dealing with thinking clearly in these situations. And definitely we pray for the lost. So, Lord, we commit ourselves unto you. But don't let us be doom and gloom, because your promises are true and you promise new mercy every morning because your faithfulness is great. So we've come to worship you and have you speak to our hearts. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. All right, we're going to do Name That Tune. So our master of Name That Tune. So those of you here for the first time, what we do is we try to honor the old hymns as well as other godly music. And to keep people in tune with the old tunes, he's going to play a tune that's in our hymn book. And if you know it, you holler it out, and then we're going to be singing it so the next generation can know these wonderful truths that are set to music. So go for it. Lord is on thy side. Very good. Be still, my soul. Yes, indeed. 290, one of my favorite songs. Believe it or not, this is actually one that I have played on the piano. 290, if you can stand, fine. If you need to stay seated, that's fine. Let the truth speak to your heart. Sometimes you got to tell your soul to be quiet. I don't know about you, but I hear voices. Some of you aren't surprised by that.
No.
Sometimes there are things that go through your mind that are trying to herd you in a way to panic, to fear, to be depressed, to be ungodly angry. And as I've said many times in this church, everything that passes through your brain either started with the spirit of the living God or a demonic spirit, and which one you embrace as truth becomes recorded in you. And if you've embraced wrong thinking in your past, Satan can try to bring up situations to bring back that wrong thinking and you act upon it. And sometimes you have to tell what's going on in your head, that's a lie from the pit of hell. That does not match who God is, what His Word says, and so be still my soul. So I appreciate the old hymns and what they challenge us to think and feel. All right, we're going to take up an offering now. We haven't done so all year, so you ought to have a... No, I'm picking. Well, I'm not picking. We haven't all year, but anyway. And I stop, and this is with all the sincerity in my heart to God. in the 28-plus years of this church, starting from basically four couples, God has never allowed us at the end of the year to be in the red. That's an amazing thing. You know why? Because God pays for what He commands. He gives us the resources. And if we honor Him with what He's given, not only will our needs be met, but we will have to give away. And this church has been faithful, I believe, up to this point by the blessings of God still on us financially, that we've tried to do with the money that you put in that offering. We're just stewards of it. We need to do what God wants to have done with that money to advance His kingdom and to point people to Him. So I'm very thankful to report to you another year of God's faithfulness. And may we continue in 2022 to be faithful to Him. 23. You're going to make that mistake when you write your first check. So don't. No. Anyway, 2023. So let's have a word of prayer. Ask God's blessing. And then somebody will pick it up and I'll go over the announcements. Lord, You are faithful. You are good. May You have our hearts so that You can continue to cause us to grow and be blessed in areas of our life, every area, including our finances, Lord. You don't want us to live as paupers, but as children of the King, that if we need something, truly need it, we can ask and we will receive of You. Turn this money into eternal value, O God. Give us wisdom. Lord, You are so faithful. And when people ask about the finances of Abundant Life Christian Fellowship, may we share about the goodness and faithfulness of You. And it's in Your name that I pray. Amen. If I'd have two people take that up. If you got a bulletin, we'll hit it. If not, we will have open gym this afternoon, 3 o'clock at the old gym at the high school. It's for everybody, anybody, all ages. We do basketball, we do volleyball, we do team dodgeball. We got people jumping on trampolines. We got people running around like crazy people. We got people sitting and talking in fellowship. So, hey, I'm going to make a confession. I gained 4 pounds over the holidays. That's a surprise because y'all thought it was more. But anyway, it's a good time to shed some.
Good.
Yeah, I did good. Especially with all the cookies and stuff. By the way, thank y'all for the gifts and stuff that y'all gave. Most of them were edible, and that's why I have 4 pounds on me. But or y'all were trying to curse me. Anyway, come out, enjoy some good fellowship, and maybe rid off some of those pounds. Tithing statement. Are y'all hot? I am burning up. I'll turn it down. Somebody else turn it down so I can continue with the announcements. But anyway, I know people are beginning to think about getting your taxes done and tithing statements. Karen's got a list out there. We'll get statements to everybody who's given, but some of you are eager beavers to get your taxes done, and some of you are like me. I usually don't have to get from the government. I usually have to give. So I'm a little slower to do these type things. But if you're an eager beaver or whatever, sign up, and she'll try to get them first come, first serve in order. Yeah, I know it's past Christmas, and evidently the last of my books that I had here, Pugh Proverbs books, I've got plenty of them at home, so I'm going to be bringing another stack. So if you want to give a belated Christmas gift or just give a book away to somebody, please come up and get those things. And as I said, whether that blesses anybody else, these are the things that have blessed my life in that book and the stories that go along with it from the Scriptures and my life and others. So we'll have some more here next week. Men's breakfast we've already. Thank you, men that come and help cook this. Men, I challenge you. If you are a teenage guy, own up. We challenge you to come to men's breakfast. We have a wonderful time of fellowship. You're not going to get a better breakfast, even though Cameron wasn't here to make his pancakes. But we had plenty of great food, and I hope you'll come out to that. That's the first Sunday of each month. Deacons, I know we normally on the first Sunday of the month have deacons meet, and we will not tonight. So we'll let our get-together meeting be when we have the church business meeting, which is January 11th. So we'll have, mine says 11th. It says 8 up there.
Next Sunday is the 8th.
I don't know. Anyway, we're going to do it next Sunday. I don't keep up with stuff like this. We have politicians that if the teleprompter go down, they sort of look like they're out nowhere. Give me a good teleprompter. No, I'm picking. Next Sunday, 6 p.m. here, we'll be voting on officers and teachers and the budget and any new business that you want to take up. Also remind you of this. We do not have church membership. We have voting privilege, which means if you've had voting privilege in 2022, it is now erased. And you need to see Karen, myself, or one of the deacons, or just show up to the meeting and we will remember that you have it. But if you have never had voting privilege here, here's how you do it. You attend 6 months regularly and say, I'd like voting privilege. I talk with you about your salvation because we want those who know the Lord to be making the Lord's decisions. And once those things are verified, you're in for the year. And at the end of the year, including me, mine's erased. But I told myself this morning I got voting privilege again, so I'm already on. I'm the only one who can vote. No, I pick it. But if you would, let somebody know. But next Sunday, whatever date that is, 6 o'clock here. Any other announcements that we have? All right, children's church workers, if you'll go to the... Oh, we hadn't sung yet. All right, see? Where's my teleprompter? All right, we're going to do some singing as unto the Lord. So we will get it right.
Good morning. Is this on? Oh, I didn't plug this in. That's why I can't hear. Now I hear. We're starting a new year. I don't know about anybody else, but I have felt the battles from the enemy coming against me stronger and stronger. And so my prayer for this new year is for God to help me evermore put my roots down into him. So, and the way Dwane puts it is when somebody throws up on him, it's not a literally somebody getting, but when somebody comes against you, they've been hijacked by the enemy, that I am able to keep my eyes on Jesus and give grace to people. That is my prayer. I don't know if that is happening to anyone else, but it sure is happening to me. And what I see coming, the world is just in such a downward spiral. The battle is getting thicker. The battle's getting harder. And you know when you see the war movies and everything ramps up and the fire gets more intense, I want to be the soldier that stands. I want to stand. And I want to continue pointing people to Jesus. And I don't want to get all flustered when somebody throws up on me. I want to stand firm and show his grace and love. And unity is the other thing I'm praying for. The early church, look what they did. The Bible says they were in one accord. Y'all, even for the enemy side, for the Tower of Babel, when they were all in one accord in unity, they were building the tower to heaven. And God had to confuse their language for them to disunify them. So I am praying for unity. So I'm going to open us in prayer as we go before him to worship. Father, we just worship you now, Lord, in this new year. And Dwane already said it, your grace and your mercy is new every day. But we're in a new year, Lord, and the battle is getting, it's growing, and it's getting more intense. So, Lord, would you please strengthen your people? Would you strengthen us in your word? And, Lord, give us more wisdom, and in your spirit, strengthen us, Lord, that we walk out what your will is, and that we show your love and grace to each other, and that we are in one accord with each other and mostly with you. That, Lord, we point people to you in these last days, that we are such a bright light in this darkness, that people see you evermore and bring revival in this land, Lord, in this church, in our community. We just thank you, Lord, and we lift up the name of Jesus now. I pray, Lord, that your spirit would so rain down and be so thick in this place. There is no place like your presence. Be with us, Lord. Your word says that the eyes of the Lord searches the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to you. Lord, strengthen us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us? Joy in the house of the Lord. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He pardoned the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory, yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out in praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out.
Won't be quiet.
stripped away, and I'll soon be calm. Longing just to breathe something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. Much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things.
Sun, at the top. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voices. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voices. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, coming as the Lion of Judah. He's coming to take his people into the clouds. Thank you, Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation.
Sins, they are many, his mercy is more. was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood in the debt we could never afford. But since there are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness.
Virginia reminded me, first of all, that sometimes y'all actually do listen to what I say. Secondly, the thing about throwing up on people. I think you need the short, full version of that story, lest it sound like something it shouldn't sound like. What I said is, churches are hospitals under the care of the great physician. Everybody here is sick. And everybody here is also a nurse, an orderly in the hospital. And just like in a hospital, if someone you're trying to care for throws up on you, don't say, "All right, get out of here, you're sick." You clean yourself up, you clean them up and try to help them get good medicine so they don't throw up anymore and they get well. It's amazing in churches that when people with problems and don't handle each other exactly right and all these difficulties, we say, "Get out of this church." If you're here because you're sick and you're looking for a cure, the great physician is on call. And we need to be his hands, his feet, his tools. And so we're all sick. Hopefully we're taking good medicine. And so we're on the mend. I'm getting better, hopefully, in 2023 than 2022. But that remains to be seen based on the two mistakes already. But anyway, it's things that really count. So now, children's church workers, you go to the back, and then young people, you follow them out. The rest of you, turn to Esther. The book of Esther will continue our verse-by-verse study. In seeing God in the circumstances, we're going to continue that theme for at least today and until we finish the book. God may occasionally have me take a break and do something else. But right now, we're going to continue to go through the book of Esther, verse by verse. We'll start at chapter 2 and seeing God in the circumstances. And we talked about the dynamic that if there is a God who is in control of everything, he does not make everything happen, but he allows what happens in our life. Nothing cannot happen in our life that if put in God's hand, God can't turn to a greater blessing than ever the difficulty it was dealing with it. And many times, as we honor God and serve Him, the things that are in our life are blessings on the front. But there's also a danger in those circumstances. David prayed, "Don't give me so much that I begin to forget you, but don't give me that keeps you from believing that God could fully love you? Are you just a broken mess that God's trying to deal with broken pieces? Some of the most beautiful mosaics are made of broken glass. And so I want you to understand that had all these things had not transpired, that didn't mean all those things were God's doing based on God's character, but God allowed the wrong of his heart, the wrong of the situation, God allowed all these circumstances, and all of a sudden, he's lonely, and he's dealing with regrets. But we're going to see God use those regrets. You know why? Because God's going to use that to fuel a search for a new queen. And in your regrets, if you lift them up to the Lord and say, Lord, first of all, if you're saved, you thank God that you're forgiven. Lord, thank you that you're not trying to get even with me for what I did. Yes, there is a sowing and reaping situation, but even that, you're not trying to get even with me. You're just trying to allow enough of the pain of my wrong choice to make it harder for Satan to trick me to make that choice again. I see the sadness in my heart and the regret, but I'm not going to let the regret go to depression or self-condemnation or something that Satan can use. I'm going to say, Lord, by your grace and your mercy, teach me the truth so I never do that again. That's what 1 John 1:9 is about. If we confess our sins, that's your part. God, I blew it. He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I regret some things that I've done, but I've not regret what I've seen God do with them when I gave them to Him. I'm thankful for what I've seen God do with the things or the mistakes that I've made that I wished I had been in that moment smart enough to not make. But I've seen God turn them all to good. And that's why I love Him the more. Verse 2, then said the king's servants that ministered unto him. See, they were there giving his food and around him, so they could see that he was struggling. He was lonely, regrets, those type things. And so they came up with an idea. Let there be fair young virgins sought for the king, and let the king appoint officers in all the provinces of his kingdom that they may gather together all the fair young virgins into Shushan the palace, to the house of the women, and to the custody of Hege. I guess that's right. Hege, Hoogie, Hoogie. I'm terrible at pronunciation. I'm a country boy. I can barely say English straight. Anyway, the custody of Hege, the king's chamberlain, keeper of the women, and let there be things for their purification be given them. And let the maiden which pleased the king be queen instead of Vashti. And the thing pleased the king, and he did so. Do you know how many women in a province, if I could show you on a map, that's about a third of the world was under Persian control. 127 provinces. So let's say, just like in the United States Miss America, which have 50 contestants, let's say there were 127 contestants of the most beautiful women in there. What's the odds? 127 to 1, if you got your math right. What's the odds? The odds are against me. And I put down there, see that in God, the odds don't matter. See God, that God can go against the odds. How many of the life stories of people in this book, what are the odds that a woman that never had sex would give birth to a baby boy? Zero, except God did it. What are the odds that somebody who had been dead 4 days, you can open the tomb and say, Lazarus, arise, and he comes out walking? Zero, unless it's God. But isn't that the point of seeing God in the circumstances? Somebody in here had cancer in one of their breasts. The odds are, if they found the lump and they see it, and now they want to scan it to know more about it, the odds are they're going to find it again. What's the odds that God's going to supernaturally heal them? What's the odds that God would have taken Adam when Mayo Clinic and they were ready to do the surgeries and peel back everything and the cancer's gone? What's the odds of a heart that was beating at what it was like 30, 20 something percent that God in Israel would send a word through somebody to say, God's healed you. And when he went back to the doctor, his heart was back at 55% efficiency, which was normal. What are the odds? God laughs at the odds. We allow the odds sometimes to freeze us. See God in the odds. Sometimes God loves, as we said during the Christmas, God loves to make something look impossible so that when he does it, everybody knows it has to be God. And he gets the glory. So when the odds are against you, don't worry about the odds. You walk in God's will. See God in those circumstances, the odds being against you. So the thing pleased the king, and so these women were got. Verse 5. Now in Shushan the palace, there was a certain Jew whose name was Mordecai, the son of Jair, the son of Shemaiah, the son of Kish, a Benjamite, who had been carried away from Jerusalem with the captivity from which he had been carried away with Jeconiah, king of Judah, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried away. Verse 7, then we'll stop. And he brought up Hadassah, that is to say, Esther, his uncle's daughter, for she had neither father nor mother, and the maid was fair and beautiful, whom Mordecai, when her father and mother were dead, took for his own daughter. What's happened in these verses? Tragedy. An enemy nation comes in, raids, destroys, kills relatives, Mordecai's relatives, leaves a girl without a father and mother. What kind of a God would do that? And allows his chosen people, the Jews, to be carried away to an ungodly nation, to be under their thumb, to serve the kingdom of the king of Babylon. Do you see God in the tragedy of your life? My dad died when I was 2 months old. And though as a baby my eyes laid on him, I couldn't tell you except by pictures what he looked like. And my mother, being a godly woman, instead of accepting the tragedy and bemoaning, and of course she grieved for my dad, and there was a missing of my dad, without a doubt. There was not any sense of anger or disappointment or that somehow the tragedy was greater than what God would do with it. And she taught this young boy, she said, God has made a promise in his word that he would be a father to the fatherless. And the tragedy of my dad dying when I was 2 months old probably is part of the reason I walk as closely to the Lord as I do, however you judge that. Because if I'd have had an earthly father, I probably would have made him more of an idol in my life. But because of what my mama taught me in the tragedy of not having a dad, she gave me truth, and truth sets free. And I never felt like God had shafted me. I never felt at a loss. Did I sometimes wish that I had an earthly father in front of me to talk to? Yes, and that's exactly how I began to talk to God, because I knew he was real. And I began to talk to him as if he was there, because he was. And I have built, by the grace of God, through the tragedy of growing up without an earthly father, I have been blessed more than if I would have had my earthly father. I'm going to see my earthly father on the other side. We've got an eternity to enjoy each other. I haven't lost my earthly father. But God was doing a greater work in the tragedy. And had my mother not seen it and allowed me to grow up with a different mindset, that tragedy would to this day haunt me. I don't know what the tragedies of your life is. Maybe you grew up in an abusive home. Maybe somebody, your parent died. Maybe you grew up poor. Maybe you grew up whatever, and there's been tragedies in your life, divorces. One of the hardest tragedies to counsel people about, I've had to do it on a couple of occasions, and I would say it's one of the hardest things to do, to look at a couple who've longed for a child, and they lose a baby and they don't have a child. God in the midst of tragedy. But I've seen those same people adopt and rescue a child. And God do a work. It doesn't mean there isn't pain in dealing with what a sin-cursed world gives you. But when you accept the role of a victim, you're a victim all your life. If you accept the role that God makes us more than conquerors through Him that loves us, there is no tragedy that can overcome you. I like in sports, hard games, as long as I win. I like in movies where the hero looks like they're in trouble and they're going to die, but I know they're going to ride off in the sunset, hopefully with a good-looking woman. God is in the tragedy in your life if you will give it to Him and see Him and ask Him, God, let me see you in this tragedy. I give it to you. Turn it into that which has eternal value, where I understand it was worth what I had to go through to produce this. So they're in a situation. They could have turned their back on God. Mordecai could have turned his back on Jehovah. Esther could have been angry at God, and that would have affected. In fact, we probably would never have read of her in the Bible. But in the tragedy, Mordecai and Esther saw God at work. Going on. I'm going to throw that thing as far as the east is from the west. It's not going to be here next week. Just count on that. Verse 8. So it came to pass when the king's commandment and his decree was heard, and when many maidens were gathered together unto Shushan the palace to the custody of Haggai, that Esther was brought also into the king's house to the custody of Haggai, keeper of the women. And the maiden pleased him, and she obtained kindness of him. And he speedily gave her the things for purification, with such things as belonged to her, and seven maidens which were he was supposed to give her out of the king's house. And he preferred her and her maids unto the best place of the house of the women. God works in situations where He gives you favor. This keeper of all these women are coming in. And because of the character of who Esther was, and because of God's hand on her for His plan, this guy said, hey, these are prima donna wannabes. This woman has inside and outside beauty. I'm impressed with her. I favor her. I want you to know that I have seen God in my life open doors of favor. Get the book and you can read some of them if you want to. But I have seen God in His mercy, for whatever reason, people disliked me or trusted me. And I got privileges that others didn't get. Doors opened that other people didn't have those opportunities. I'll give you one just to let you know that I do have real stories of life that I've lived. I went to, it was during the summer, August, in the 70s, late 70s, mid 70s. My mom wanted me to go to the a revival one of our cousin's churches. Mom, we didn't have a car. Mom didn't drive. So they had to come pick us up. And so we went to this church service, the people preached. And I went because my mom asked me to, because I was also 15. I was hoping there's some good-looking girls there. I'm just being honest. That was part of the incentive also. So go, it was good service, everything. And after the service, you know, I get up and get ready to go out the pew to the car. And the preacher and some other guy come up to me, and they introduce themselves, and it was the minister and the principal of the Christian school they had here, and they said, you're the type of young person we want in our school. And they talked to me about a work scholarship. Now listen, I was willing to go to school and do the work, but the work to go to school to do the work, I wasn't really in. But they were nice, and they had opened this door and this opportunity, and I said, well, my mother and I will talk about it. We'll pray about it. But on the way driving home in the car, I'm thinking, I am not working. I'm not getting up early to go to school and mop floors and empty trash cans and clean toilets. And then, no, I'm not doing that. And so in my heart, I didn't see God in those circumstances. But God said, I got an open door for you, buddy. So I'm in my underwear. Don't picture that, by the way. I'm in my underwear. And there's a knock on our door. So Mom goes to the door, and I'm in another room. And I hear my cousins say that, and they didn't know that I was going to turn it down, that someone connected with the church said that if I was willing to come, they would pay my entire way for 2 years. And they never laid eyes on me. Never, they didn't go to church there. It was a relative of somebody, I think, because they wanted to remain anonymous, but I tried to track it down, and I think I know who may have done it. There's an open door where God gave me favor out of the blue. And I saw God's hand, and I said, well, I reckon I'm going to Christian school my last 2 years. Didn't know a soul. It was 2-3 weeks before school started. Showed up, and God's hand was in it. I'd never known anything about soccer without going to that school. And y'all know how God used soccer in my life. God's favor. I wouldn't trade anything for God's favor. Don't think that you're advanced by your own strength, by your own looks, by your own wisdom, by your own anything. It's the favor of God. I would rather be blessable than anything in the world. Blessability opens up all doors. If you're not blessable, there are certain things God can't do in you and through you. And so, see God in the fact that He gives you favor. He also gives you responsibilities that you hadn't anticipated. This guy was going to have all these women over him, but also Mordecai. He had on his doorstep, when they were taken in captivity, he had his, it says his uncle, but they were cousins. This word in Hebrew leans more to the idea of a cousin. But he had a cousin that she, he was his own, her only relative. And it was sort of thrust upon him to try to raise this girl in a foreign land. I don't know if you've ever had responsibilities thrust on you that you really didn't want. Maybe more and more it's true that grandparents are raising grandchildren. And you may say, I'm too old and if God has brought a responsibility to you, God will give you the strength if you turn to Him to fulfill that responsibility. Once again, out of my own life, I never intended to start a church. I would have told you 30 years ago. Well, I had to think how many years ago. We've been in here 28 plus. I would have told you 30 years ago, God would have to send a neon sign from heaven for me to start a church. I have no desire to do that. And God brought the responsibility of saying, I want you to go up and start a church. God, I know I studied it in college, but I don't know what I'm doing. But God's made it happen. And God's blessed and God's groomed. So if God gives you a responsibility, He'll help you through it. A couple more verses and then we'll stop. All right? She got the best stuff. She got preferential treatment because the head of all the women liked her. Favor. Verse 10. Esther had not showed her people nor her kindred, for Mordecai had charged her that she should not show it. You got secrets. I got secrets. Do you know God is in the things that you don't tell people? Some people say just about all their business. They just can't help rattling off stuff. You know, some things are better left unsaid. Some things should be kept private between you and God. And so Mordecai had said to Esther, Esther, listen, don't let them know you're a Jew. We're in a foreign land. You don't know how that might affect people in dealing with you. Keep it a secret. So inquiring minds want to know. What secret do you got? And which one should you keep to yourself to your dying day? Which ones are for a later time to reveal? I don't know. I don't know. But I know God was in her not telling everything she knew about something, about a situation. There are a lot of times I don't tell everybody everything I know. That's very easy because I don't know a lot. But there are times where there are things that I think and know. God says, let them learn that on their own. You know, that's the hardest thing to do with adult children. You know why? Because sometimes you can tell them and they think you're trying to run their lives like they were 8 years old again. And you just tell them what you can and then you shake your head and think, you got a lot to learn, buddy. Or baby. You got a lot to learn. But that's between you and God. And so he kept secret. Last thing in this thing before we do this. Mordecai gave charge that she shouldn't show up. Verse 11, and Mordecai walked every day before the court of the women's house to know how Esther did and what would become of her. So his routine, once she got old enough and she was chosen as somebody and taken to the palace for a year, every day his morning routine. They didn't have coffee back then, so he went for a walk. So he gets up, gets dressed, and he walks there by the palace door where he could see or find information from Esther. You say, big deal. Well, it is a big deal. It's recorded in Scripture. You say, why did God record this in Scripture? Well, if you know the story, we're going to get to the point that when Mordecai didn't show up for 3 days, Esther knew something was wrong and sent word to find out what was wrong. And then she found out the danger that her people were in. But all that started by a routine. By a routine that Mordecai just said, you know, I need to check on Esther every day. So I'm going to go by the palace every morning, see how she's doing it. Esther, you know, are you in there somewhere? And finding word from her. Do you know, God is even in the routine of your life, what you do and don't do. See God in it. Just by the happenstance. What do you go by every day and see? What do you run across this person every day? See God in the circumstance. There's a reason even for those things fitting together in your life. Nothing happens by accident. God is in the routine that you do, doing something. You say, what if my routine is not a godly routine? Well, God's going to show you some things in that routine. God's in that routine. What if somebody has an explosive temper? They get under pressure, they get angry, they fly off. And this is a pattern. And that's their routine of how they handle these type of situations. And, you know, a lot of people try to beg off and say, well, I can't help it, that's just me. No, that's your routine. And God's allowing that thing to continue to happen so you can see you got a spiritual problem here, buddy. This is a pattern. Some routines God's in. I have a routine. I do not go to bed without having my devotions. I don't know about you. I can't survive. I can't handle life. I can't without spending time with God. I've said this. If I miss my devotions, my time with God talking to me in the Word and me talking to God, if I miss that one day, I can tell the difference in me. I can tell the difference in my spirit. I can tell the difference in my attitude to things happen. If I miss devotions 2 days, and I couldn't tell you the last time I've ever missed it in 2 days, I really can't. My wife will know it. 3 days, everybody knows it. Dwayne's not the same. You know why? The Spirit of God is what makes me who I am. It releases the righteousness that God has produced in me. But without it, that desire to do right is bottled up in my flesh and the world and the devil keep me locked up. And it is my routine. And I see God in it. I make the connection between having devotions, God's strength for the day, not having devotions, being set up for Satan to kill, rob, and destroy. So, see God in your routines. Make sure you have the right routines. If you don't know the Lord as Savior, God wants you to choose Him today, because He wants you to see that you are watching, or you are here, and it is not by accident. And you have heard this message that God has used to speak to your heart. And it's not because of eloquent speaking. It's because of the Spirit of the living God. See God in that. Respond to God speaking to your hearts. And begin 2023 saying, Lord, You're my Lord. You're my God. You're in control of me. And I want to walk with You this day and every day. Shall we pray? Lord, thank You. Thank You for the beauty of Your Word. Thank You for what You record and how practical and real it is. Thank You, Lord, for even the people that are watching and how this has spoken to their heart, hit them, or things that went right over their head, whatever, it doesn't matter. Cause them to focus on what You're saying to their hearts and help them to respond to You during this invitation. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Invitation. There's no better place to be than in God's hands. Not fighting to squeeze out between the fingers, but resting deeply in His loving hands, His nail-pierced hands. Let's stand for dismissal, but let God continue to work in your hearts. You don't run off if you don't want to. Fellowship with one another as long as you can. Say hey to somebody before you leave. Father, we thank You for this first day of 2023 that we spent it, I believe, worshiping You in this place. May our hearts continue to worship You, and You are faithful to us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.